I'll tell you why I can't find you. Every time I brought you a fish, you've gone fishing.
Ah, you know.
But there's a sign upon your door. Gone fishing.
I'm real gone,
man. You ain't working anymore.
Could be.
There's your hole out in the sun. Where you left the road half done. You climbed the hole and there ain't no fun.
But I can prove it.
You ain't got no ambition. Gone fishing.
This is Keith Peel bringing to you another recorded talk on fishing from the library of Alveys, makers of the world-famed fishing reels. You may have seen a similar slide tape in which we dealt with method and gear in tailor fishing. We now deal with where to fish, that it may help you to be aware of the type of water in which you are fishing. I make no apology for beginning on a very elementary note, showing simply the drawing of the action of a breaking wave. The bottom drawing is where sand is flat and no gutter exists. The wave breaks well out and runs up with small white caps up the beach. The top drawing shows the wave over deeper water, how it does not tumble until nearer shore and often cuts a ridge in the sandy shoreline by the force of its heavier break. In this drawing, we have added an outer sandbank forming a close-in gutter. Following the wave pattern from 1 to 6, it will be seen that when the leading edge strikes the outer bank, it not only causes the wave to tumble and foam, but also makes the wave rise in height. The wave will reform as it enters the deep gutter and topple and break on reaching the shoreline. Be conversant with this pattern, for it is the wave action which will tell you, even on the dark nights, that there is an outer bank and an inshore gutter and just where it is. But this is just a start, for there is more to a beach than an inner gutter. Other things you must be able to recognise are sand spits, flats, holes, runouts and tidal set, for each have their place in deciding where you will fish. By now, you will have started to accept the terms used by us, even though you may know a gutter as a channel, a sandbank as a bar, or a hole as a run-up. This drawing shows a V-gutter with a wide access opening to the north, which is a common type on our coastline. Arrows show how the waves crossing the sand spit disturb the sand, unearthing particles of food, and bringing them into the gutter. While there will be some drift in the gutter, it will not be as fierce as the outside water. Now we have a double-ended gutter with a central runout. Water enters this gutter over both sandbanks, and the water level equalizes itself by pouring out of the runout. The arrows show how this brings about a confused water pattern. And while the gutter on the right of the runout would follow the outside drift north, the section on the left would run south towards the runout. Excessive drift or run can often be avoided by working this type of water. We now look at a sand spit which is formed on the shoreline. These are easily located even at night by the peculiar V pattern which forms as the wave breaks on the point and runs up either side. Often a slight bend or corner in the beach shore is an indication that a sand spit exists. This shallow water permits you to wade out some yards before casting and gives the extra distance needed to reach fish which are wide out. A double gutter is not so often encountered, but must be treated with caution, for unless you are near the top of the tide, it is not likely that fish will hole up in the inner gutter. At low water, if it is possible to wade out to the inner bank and cast to the inside of the outer bank, you may then have a good possibility of finding Tailor. Any reasonably small outer bank with a good access or run out at either end will often produce fish right through a tide. In this pattern, slow-moving, confused water would exist at either end of the bank, and could be fished with very little difficulty. But when two such pronounced outlets exist, the fish may travel through without staying to feed, following the movement of baitfish in the tidal current. When there is no break in the outer bank directly in front of a sand spit, it is very often found that there is a corresponding build-up of sand coming in from the outer bank. It will have disturbed but reasonably slack water on its lee side, so it is well worth a try. Look for some feature at all times, for this is what the tailor does. Having given thought to the theory shown by line drawings, we can now pass on to actual shorelines. To assess the value of any spot, we must reason that tailor have come close into shore to feed and to evade their enemies. No fish will feed until he feels secure, and he is inclined to stay close to the inside edge of the outer bank for this reason. He likes having one side protected and the shelter of the cover of the foamy water produced by the breaking wave. He wants reasonable depth of water with a quick access and escape exit, such as shown at the extreme right of this picture. Most of our beaches have a sand hill or headland close adjacent, and from this vantage point a long stretch of the beach can be evaluated. You note the indentations, holes and gutters, keeping in mind that little spots from hilltops are quite big when you get to them. Similarly, others that look good may be too wide when you try to cast the distance. But by taking landmarks, you can now go down and inspect them at closer quarters. The V gutter we had selected looked quite worthwhile when we reached it. Deep enough for tailor, white foamy water, and on this calm day, disturbed enough to be of interest to the fish. The shallow end sand spit on the right of the picture shows up in the peculiar wave pattern which we mentioned previously. Although the water is clear and it is the middle of a calm, sunny day, tailor were in here because the features were there to hold them. Whether they liked the constant shadow of the foam or the oxygen content in the water, mere human will never know. But the oxygen theory is favoured, as a lot of fish are taken from water not actually foam covered, but having an obvious bubble content. A good run out was noted at the northern end of the gutter, giving them an escape path when the tide began to drop. The clouded water on the left of the picture shows how the water often appears more sandy as it leaves the gutter and is easily identified. Mainly, of course, the gutter has to be narrow enough for you to put a bait where it should go. With good gear, it is not difficult to reach the inside of the bank where that foam is breaking, even without using lead weight. Practice surf casting until you can throw a bait straight and true and obtain reasonable distance with just the garfish bait. Looking at other places, previously we said how a deep inshore gutter usually identifies itself by cutting a shelf in the shoreline bank. This helps a lot to pinpoint the deep section, even on the darkest night. There is a 2-foot shelf between the angler and his son, and the gutter in front is clearly seen to be deep and full of character. We said also that the wave rose in height before it toppled and broke. By remembering this, you can easily locate the outer bank, and by the way the wave reforms, you can gauge the depth of the gutter. I think by now you will appreciate how important it was to study the waves, for it is in this way that you read the contour of the seabed. Remember also to locate that unbroken water between the two banks, which provides the runout, for this is a deciding factor in selecting the right area in which to cast. Only if you were fishing for mulloway, sharks, or the bigger fish waiting to feed on tailor would you position yourself to cast into the centre of a runout. Tailor seldom venture out from the cover of the bank unless there is some very good reason. In a V gutter, the runout will be showing at the extreme end of the gutter. Wherever it is, look for it, for it will tell you what direction of tidal sweep can be expected and much about the whole behaviour pattern of the water in the gutter. You'll reason out where a fish would be, why he would be there, before you make your cast. A good beach angler tries to see just what is in front of him, just as though he were looking down from an aircraft, as seen in this picture. The banks, holes and gutters are easily seen and defined when viewed from above, but as this aid is rarely available, the angler must draw his own mental picture from what he can see from the shore. At times, small channels and holes will be shaped directly into the beach slope, as seen in this picture. Do not discard these spots, particularly in heavy weather near the top of the tide. When Tailor decide to shelter in such a place, it is only a short cast to reach them, and as the fish are caught, they begin a frenzy of wild feeding, sometimes lasting for hours. While beach formation constantly changes, even at times during one tide, it is of undoubted help if the angler has a good memory and plenty of observance. A study of beaches at low tide will show places that, while of little use now, will develop into good fishing water as 6 feet or more tidal rise occurs. Such a place is this V-shaped gutter. Again, we see on the right hand of the picture what is only a small pothole now, but you can imagine what a hot spot it could be when the tide reaches the usual high water mark, shown by the difference in the colour of the sand. The alteration in wave pattern over shallows and deeper water is also clearly shown in this picture. And so we go along the beach, noting these places and remembering their shape, so that we can return later to use them as likely fishing water. There is no guarantee that fish will come into them, but at least we have reckoned that there is a good reason why they may. And if they do, we will know how to fish it and where to cast. Perhaps by now you have said that these formations don't exist on the beaches where you do your fishing. This could easily be, for a lot depends on the type and variations of winds and ocean currents which occur in the area. But I think you will appreciate how important beach reading is to us, and accept that wherever the place, there is usually a reason why Tailor stopped to feed. Also, you have seen how depth of water causes a colour change that soon becomes apparent to you, even when the surface is flecked with foam. The deep blue water gutter on the left centre of this picture would catch your eye as a likely spot to find a fish almost as soon as it was seen. The features which fish like can sometimes be more stable than shifting sand formations. Clusters of rocks within casting distance of the shoreline will often attract small marine life, providing an attractive food pocket which will hold Tailor in the vicinity. Similar gutters and holes are often provided by sunken reefs just offshore. In some places, this would be the first place you would try. But don't forget that breaks in the reef give a similar run-out pattern, provide disturbance to the tidal set, and should be assessed in the same manner. A knowledge of the reef shape can save the loss of a lot of bottom gear rigs. Have a look at the place at dead low tide. Gutters from rocks, like those on the beach, are better when small enough to hold fish together. This type of long, deep channel may produce the occasional big tailor, but would not be regarded as good water for schools of feeding fish. Yet it is from these rock-faced, deep channel types of water that other species, such as this mulloway, are taken. It would also have the features to attract sharks, trevally and surface feeding, kingfish, mackerel and tuna. If your beach fishing is patterned on a long weight, for that extra big fish of these types, your reasoning would possibly lead you to such a place. But as tailor are by far the most prolific species on our beaches, we have planned this talk to help you find them. If you hook into an 11-pound beauty such as this one on a 12-pound line, you will know you are beach fishing, for there are few finer fighters for this size than tailor. They use every possible trick to get a little slack line to give them their freedom, such as tail walking and jumping away from or swimming straight toward the fisherman. You could confidently expect to have a beach catch of tailor from 2 to 6 pound, with a few silver bream up to 3 pound if conditions are reasonable. For once you find fish feeding in a close to shore gutter, they are very ready to take a bait and the action is constant. Some good beach anglers contend that by grouping and fishing close together, the constant bait supply will keep the fish in the vicinity, causing them to become excited in their feeding. It is, therefore, not unusual to find 20 or 30 fishermen almost shoulder to shoulder when the tailor are on. This presents a severe test of your casting and fishing ability. But whether you fish in a group or on your own, whether it be dawn or dusk, day or night, it will always be of great advantage if you can read a beach. Each and every cast you make should have had some reasoning and forethought to its direction if you want to be a regularly successful tailor fisherman. If our look at beach formations together has inspired you to be more observant in the future, our time has been well spent. Even in our enlightened age, we know comparatively little of the breeding and feeding habits of fish, but if we can apply the knowledge we do have, it must lead to better fishing. Thank you for your attention.
We gone fishing and stay. Ba 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 ba